As I stated earlier, the vast majority of microwave filters are bandpass filters. Really, we divide bandpass filters into two varieties. One we call wideband, the other called narrowband. For wideband filters, the bandwidth is defined typically with two numbers. One frequency, which defines the highest half power point, cutoff point, and the a second frequency, a lower value, that describes the second half power point. Now, these frequencies are almost always described in hertz. Up till now, mathematically, we've been talking about omega, the radians per second, the radial frequency. And of course, that's because it shows up in our complex exponentials, e to the j, omega t. From an engineering standpoint, though, it is more helpful, it's easier to describe frequencies instead of radians per second in terms of cycles per second. And of course, the difference between frequency and cycles per second and frequency and radians per second is the factor 2 pi. So take omega, divide by 2 pi, and that will give you the frequency f in cycles per second. And of course, cycles per second is more commonly known these days as hertz. So the numbers that we give are for bandwidth, filter bandwidth, are almost always expressed in hertz. More specifically, we'll express it in terms of generally megahertz, millions of cycles per second, or gigahertz, billions of cycles per second. So for example, we might say a bandpass filter has a band with a pass band that runs from, let's say, 1.3 gigahertz to 2.6 gigahertz or something like that. anyway, so that's how specify typically the bandwidth of a wide band filter. What about a narrow band filter? A narrowband filter we describe with two frequency values as well, but instead of the low frequency and high frequency, typically we'll describe its passband in terms of a center frequency, which is the frequency at the center of the passband, and then a bandwidth given in hertz or megahertz, gigahertz, or whatever. And this is the delta. This delta is simply the difference between the high half power point and the low frequency, half power frequency, all right. The high half-power frequency and the low half-power frequency. The difference between these two, then, is the delta, is the bandwidth in hertz. And then again, F0 is the center. Now, there is a bit of an ambiguity associated with the center frequency. Generally speaking, engineers and students would think that center frequency is determined from the arithmetic average. We can simply go through and take FL and FH and add them and divide by 2, and of course that would be the frequency that's halfway between FH and FL. It would be the value FL plus delta F over 2, or the value of FH minus delta F over 2. But there's a different way, an alternative way, of describing the center frequency. And this way is actually very useful and shows up sort of naturally in much of our engineering analysis. And that is the geometric average. The geometric average of two numbers is to multiply them together and take the square root. So we have the arithmetic average and the geometric average. Let's say we wanted to take the arithmetic average of three values. Well, simply we'd add those three values together and divide by 3. How would we take the geometric average of three values? In that case, we'd multiply those three values together, take the product of those three values, and then take the cube root. And you can see where we could extend that for any number of elements that we use to have the average. So generally, we think of average as the arithmetic average, but the geometric average, again, can be very useful in electrical engineering, and turns out to be sort of a natural way of describing the center frequency mathematically when it comes to microwave filters. Having said all that, for the most part, particularly if we have a narrowband filter, the difference between the arithmetic average and the geometric average in terms of their numeric value is fairly slight, and so usually a distinction between the two is not always made. A third way of describing the bandwidth of a microwave filter is by using the percentage bandwidth. And the percentage bandwidth is as defined as the ratio of delta F, the bandwidth of the filter itself, divided by its center frequency. And of course, this would give you a fraction. If you wanted percentage, you would need to multiply it by 100%. So if the bandwidth is 1/10 the value of the center frequency, we would get a 0.1, or give us a 10% bandwidth, for example. Notice the percent bandwidth can be larger than 100%. When the bandwidth, percent bandwidth, is 100%, it means that FL, the low end, is 50% of F0, and F high is 1.5 times F0. And so in that case, we find that F high is a value that is 3 times larger than FL. So we have a 3-to-1 bandwidth in that case. So that'd be a very wideband filter, but we could have even larger band filters so that the percentage bandwidth could be higher than 100. We asked ourselves the question, what's the difference in a narrowband filter and a wideband filter? I said that we characterize filters in that way, narrowband or wideband. These are subjective adjectives, however. There's not a specific numerical cutoff between one or the other. But generally speaking, we can say that whether it's narrowband or wideband depends on a couple of things. One is the percent bandwidth. I would say a filter whose bandwidth is, let's say, less than 10% is a narrowband filter. But again, that's just me. It's completely subjective. Other engineers might say, no, it needs to be less than 5%. Or other engineers might say as much as 15% would be considered narrowband in their mind. The second parameter, though, that is used to determine whether it's narrowband or wideband is the technology used to construct filters. Making a good microwave filter that works on a matched system is a difficult task. And it's not something that you can use one type of technology or one idea to be able to construct any possible filter. As we'll see later, there's lots of parameters associated with filters. Foremost, of course, is the bandwidth itself. But even among that, the technologies required are very different. One of the things that changes is with center frequency of the bandpass. As the center frequency goes to relatively low frequencies in the, let's say, tens or hundreds of megahertz, all the way up into very high frequencies, and let's say the tens of gigahertz, the ways that we can use to construct filters will change. The other thing is the percentage bandwidth. As it gets narrower, percentage-wise, the devices that we can use to build the filter are different than if we can use, if we're trying to construct rather, a wider band filter with a larger percentage bandwidth. And so these two things, percent bandwidth and bandwidth rather, and the technology used to construct it, sort of define whether we have a wideband filter or a narrowband filter. So for example, let's say we want to build a relatively wide band filter. One of the things we can use are simple lumped elements, inductors and capacitors. But we can only use these really at low center frequencies. So a wide band filter that spans a bandwidth, let's say, in the tens of megahertz, maybe to hundreds of megahertz, we might be able to use lumped elements just like we might use in any low frequency application. As we go higher in frequency, though, even though the bandwidth may stay the same, but we move into hundreds of megahertz into gigahertz, we can no longer really use inductors, capacitors, lumped elements, because the parasitics of the leads simply become too significant at those high frequencies. Even though the parasitic capacitances and inductances are relatively small, such that we can ignore them at low frequencies, at high frequencies, capacitors start behaving like something different than a capacitor, and likewise for the inductors. Instead, it turns out that we can use distributed elements, and distributed elements are simply links of lossless transmission lines, typically terminated in either a short or an open, so that the input impedance is purely reactive. And of course, we can use that then to replace inductors, capacitors, which are purely reactive elements. So we can have a two-port device, which is a capacitor, or we can have a two-port device, which is a length of transmission line that is terminating a short circuit or open circuit. That could give us an impedance which is either positively reactive, in other words, inductive, or negatively reactive, in other words, capacitive. And so we can build structures using these lengths of transmission lines. And so here's an example of a microstrip circuit for a filter. And we look at this, and it sort of looks like artwork, or maybe, you know, looks like the logo of some new startup company, Unu or something. But this is actually a microstrip circuit. The gold is the topside conductor of the microstrip circuit board. The yellow here is the dielectric, the top, the dielectric substrate of the printed circuit board. On the bottom side would be a ground plane there. And so these are transmission lines. You can see these are just sort of links of transmission lines, in this case terminated on either end with an open circuit, likewise here and here. It doesn't appear that they're connected together, but they actually are electromagnetically. What we have here is a coupling between these transmission lines, both a capacitive coupling, this is probably predominant, but also an inductive coupling between the two. You need two wires that come close together, of course, have both capacitive and inductive coupling between the mutual inductance between the two of them. And so this actually is a bandpass filter. And this kind of shows that making bandpass filters aren't for, well, you have to be pretty smart to be able to go through and get these things to work. It's not apparent what the equivalent circuit model for this certainly would be. But this is the kind of thing that we would use if we wanted to use a higher frequency filter in terms of its center frequency, but the percentage bandwidth is still relatively large. If we start to get percentage bandwidths that are less than 3%, it turns out neither one of these technologies are going to work particularly well. If we want to make very narrowband filters, then we have to resort to other technology, other methodologies for constructing our filters. Essentially, then we start to need to use resonators, highly resonant elements. And there are a number of these resonant elements in electrical engineering. We have things we call dielectric cavities, which are electromagnetic resonators that kind of look like a little plastic hockey puck. Crystals, actually, quartz crystals have a very high resonant behavior from their crystalline structure, something called surface acoustic waves, which is a device that basically will transform electromagnetic energy into acoustic energy and back again. And so we actually build little acoustic resonators there, and the benefit there is you can make them very small, then convert back and forth from electromagnetic energy. So all these are the kinds of technologies we might use to build a very narrowband filter. Still, there's a limit on how narrow we can make a bandpass filter. Making a bandpass filter with a percentage bandwidth less than 0.1% is exceedingly difficult, even with a very high Q resonator. So there is a limit in terms of the percentage bandwidth that we can build for a microwave filter. In other words, you're not going to build a microwave filter that's, let's say, centered at 25 gigahertz and has a passband of 300 kilohertz. That's not something that is doable. On the next page, I'm going to show a chart that's provided by K&L Microwave. K&L Microwave is a rare company, I think, back in 40 years ago, when I was designing radar receivers. K&L Microwave was really the standard of microwave filter design, and by far the preeminent company, at least in my opinion, when it came to microwave filters. Most of the companies I dealt with 40 years ago are no longer around. They've been bought or sold or merged or something, and their name is different, and I don't recognize them, and I don't know what happened to all the other companies that I dealt with, the vendors that I bought components from back 40 years ago. The exception there is K&L Microwave. K&L Microwave is still around, still making microwave filters, and I assume still the preeminent microwave filter vendor that's out there. So I recommend them. I have no financial interest in K&L Microwave, by the way. I'm just based on my experience, mainly from 40 years ago, that I highly recommend them. But anyway, they have a chart on the next page, and it talks about the different filters they make. And it talks about them in terms of their their center frequencies and also in terms of their percentage bandwidth. And what you'll find is there are many different kinds of filters they built, and it all depends on the center frequency, again, going from low frequency to high frequency, or from narrow band percentage-wise to wide band percentage. The kinds of physical technologies we use to build filters will change. So look at this chart here, and first of all, notice the horizontal axis we have frequency, and this is a logarithmic, at least most of it is a logarithmic. So we have 0.01 gigahertz and then 0.1 gigahertz, which of course would be 100 megahertz, 1 gigahertz, 10 gigahertz, and then it becomes more linear, 20, 30, 40 gigahertz there. These black bars correspond to a bandwidth. And this is not the bandwidth of the filter. This is the range of center frequencies. If you want to design a filter, for example, with the center frequency between 1 and 3 gigahertz, then you would use this series, C50 or whatever it is, a cavity. And the reason this says cavity is a resonator, and you can look here then for this cavity series and see that the percent bandwidths are small, 0.2 to 3.5, 0.2 to 3, 0.1 to 0.8. And so this is a narrow band filter technology there. And again, depending on what your center frequency is, you would use any number of different technologies or design criteria that they would use there. Let's see, let's go down here and look at the lumped component. Lumped component are inductors, capacitors there. And if we look at that, we find that the center frequency, to use in lumped elements, have to be somewhere between basically 1 megahertz all the way up to about 100 megahertz. And that's what I was talking about. When we use lumped elements, inductors, capacitors, we really need to stay below 100 megahertz for them to be useful there. And if we look at the percent bandwidth, we're talking here a value from 1 to 200. Excuse me. So the lumped element then is, again, low frequencies and relatively wide percentage bandwidths there. Let's see what else we might show here. Well, you can just see all the different technology. Suspended substrate is basically a sort of a microstrip kind of technology that they use for building filters and networks. Let's say between 2 and 18 gigahertz for a center frequency there. But this kind of shows you that there's no one way to build a microwave filter. It requires lots of different techniques, lots of different technologies, lots of different physical elements. It's required is because all the different center frequencies from very low to very high, and also percentage bandwidths from very low to very high.